Good evening. I am Dr. Saravanan. I am a GI surgeon and I am currently a consultant at Apollo Proton Cancer Center. And my area of interest is HPV and GI cancers. And I am going to talk about hidradenitis disease of liver today. Are my slides seen?
You need to make it full screen and then.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Yes.
So hidradenitis disease, we often remember this picture of the membranes which are floating. Reminds me more of the coconut which we often see. So to begin with, the problem statement, echinococcosis affects nearly about 1 million people at any given time, and it is responsible for almost about 20,000 deaths every year. This accounts to about 8,71,000 disability adjusted life years globally. And it also costs a lot of billions of dollars, not only in terms of human losses, but also for the industry, for the livestock. These data are from the 2015 World Health Organization data. And to broadly give a overview, there are four kinds of parasites, out of which two are important for us. One is the cystic echinococcal disease, which is caused by the Echinococcus granulosis, and the alveolar echinococcal disease, which is caused by the Echinococcus multilocularis. The other two forms are not so common or clinically relevant, that is the E. vogeli causing polycystic echinococcal disease and E. oligarthus, which cause unicystic disease. Probably it may have a significance from MCQ point of view. As we know, these parasites are will cause diseases which are very indolent, very slow growing, and generally they are asymptomatic to begin with, and more often they are diagnosed incidentally, commonly done on an ultrasound or a CT scan. With the advent of imaging going up, the incidence is higher. The amongst these, the cystic echinococcosis are usually, they start showing up symptoms once they are larger in size because of the size, the stretch, or because of the complications, especially the sepsis related complications, and they produce significant morbidity. Whereas the alveolar echinococcal disease, these are notorious because they are infiltrative in nature. They appear like malignancies. They even have deposits in multiple locations resembling metastasis. They often manifest with pain and jaundice, and untreated, the mortality can be as high as 90%. If we look at the epidemiology, how is the geographical distribution of this disease? This is 2011 data from, again, from WHO. And if we see that there is a preponderance to affect northern hemisphere, especially for the alveolar echinococcosis, it commonly affects China, Russia, parts of North America and Europe. Whereas the cystic echinococcosis or the hidradenitis liver does not have any such preponderance for hemisphere. It affects parts of South America, especially Argentina, Central Asia, especially parts of China, eastern part of Africa. In India, it is more commonly seen in the southern states of the erstwhile Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. The incidence can be as high as 200 in every 1 lakh population every year in the endemic areas for cystic echinococcosis. However, for alveolar echinococcosis, it's less common. It's to the tune of about only 1 per every 1 lakh population every year. The parasite cycle, everybody would know. I'll just refresh through it quickly. So the definite host is usually the carnivores, that is the fox or the dogs. And the intermediate hosts are the herbivores, commonly sheep. Man happens to be an accidental intermediate host. So these worms are found in the gut of the carnivores. The worm has a head and the proglottids. The gravid segments of these eventually will be released as eggs, and they will go on to the atmosphere from where it is ingested by the herbivores. And these then penetrate the intestinal wall of the herbivores. From there, they enter the portal circulation, go on to liver and other organs. When they die, they are then eaten again by the carnivores, and that's how the cycle completes. However, if instead of it getting ingested by the true intermediate host, that is the herbivores, if it goes to a human being, then it produces the disease. There are several strains which are described, of which the G1 strain is the most common, which affects the sheep. So what happens to the pathology? How does it develop and how does it have a clinical picture? How it alters the clinical picture? So from the portal circulation, it goes on to the liver, where since the portal blood flow is more common to the right lobe is more commonly affected. And there it starts growing at a very slow rate. Usually the rate is about less than 1 millimeter every year. As it slowly grows, it will develop the inner germinal layer and the outer laminated layer. Further to this, the body will have an immune mechanism which will react to this, and there will be some calcific focus and fibrotic component coming up, which is the pericyst. Eventually, as these grow, they can cause compression of the adjacent structures. Commonly, it will affect the bile ducts. It can produce obstructive jaundice. And also, if they are more closer to the surface, they can rupture, cause a leak, which can produce allergic phenomenon, anaphylactic symptoms, because they are highly immunological and produce elevated levels of immunoglobulins. And also, when they leak into the peritoneum, they will seed and produce secondary hydatidosis at those areas. These also are prone to sepsis as they grow. It can be either a primary infection or it can be a secondary infection when they open into biliary channels, and they can produce cholangitis. The diagnosis of the cystic disease is based on imaging, which is the cornerstone. And usually an ultrasound abdomen will be able to pick up the pathognomonic signs, which I will allude to in the subsequent slides. But there is a role for other forms of cross-sectional imaging like CT and MR, especially when there is a suspicion of extra-abdominal disease. In complicated situations like an abscess or when you're suspecting a cystobiliary communication, if a pre-surgical evaluation to decide the surgical plan, it helps. And also when other differential diagnosis is considered and the findings on the ultrasound are equivocal, in that case, a cross-sectional imaging is necessary. Serology has a poor role because it is not very sensitive. It is based on multiple factors, including the location, the intactness of the cyst wall, viability of the organism, and hence it is variable. It only has a collaborative kind of a role. It is not a diagnostic tool by itself. So coming to the Garbi classification and the WHO classifications, as we already know. So broadly, what is the difference between the two? In the WHO, you have the initial CL or the clear cyst, which is not there in the Garbi classification. In the clear cyst, how is it different from the CE1 or the Garbi1, which is also a univesicular cyst? The difference between the two is that in CL, WHO, there is no wall and the contents are anechoic, whereas in CE1, there is a wall and the contents are echoic. The CE2 of WHO classification is the multiseptate or the rosette-like appearance or the honeycomb appearance because of the multiple daughter cysts. This is corresponds to Garbi3, and the CE3 of WHO corresponds to 2. So there is a flip-flop between 2 and 3 between Garbi and WHO. That is the only major difference, and then additional CL which is there in the WHO. So the CE3 again has A and B. A is the classical Lilly sign or the detached membrane, and in CE3B, the difference between CE3A and 3B is mainly that the daughter cysts which are there in 3B are amongst a solid matrix. So is not a solid matrix. C4 is where you have a heterogeneous appearance because of degenerated membranes and the daughter cysts are no longer there. And C5 is where there is a calcification. How does it matter clinically, this classification? It matters because it tells us about the viability of the parasite. So C1 and 2 indicates that it is an active disease. C3, it has started degenerating, it is in a transitional state. And C4 and 5 means that they are this inactive, and thereafter further intervention is not needed. Now, what are the common dilemmas one faces in diagnosis? The differentials that one would think of would include a simple cyst, biliary cystadenoma, and sometimes it masquerades a malignancy that is more common in the alveolar echinococcosis. The biliary cystadenoma, when do you suspect? So when you encounter a cyst in the liver, more commonly in a female patient, in a setting where it has been operated and then it has recurred, in that situation one should suspect. The imaging features where the one should consider a biliary cystadenoma is when the septa are enhancing, when you have papillary projections or mural nodules. And sometimes one may need to allude to a cyst fluid aspiration to check for any scoliosis. And often after it is, in retrospect, after the resection has been done, when you look at the wall histopathology, you realize that it is a biliary cystadenoma and the treatment plan gets changed completely. For example, this is one of the patients that we had come across during my training, 34-year-old lady with recurrent episodes of jaundice. Bilirubin was around 3. The imaging showed a simple cyst in the liver, we thought, and there was a bile duct which was dilated with an abrupt cutoff. So we thought we are dealing with a cholangiocarcinoma in the extrahepatic biliary tree, and we thought she will need a bile duct excision. Intra-op, what we saw was that in addition to that cyst which we can see in the segment 4, the dilated bile duct can be seen. So we took a stay suture, divided the bile duct distally. To our surprise, what we found that inside that there was this membrane kind of a thing which came out. So we thought now we are dealing with a hydatid cyst. When we pulled it out, it seemed like it was communicating with that segment 4 cyst. So that this was completely delivered. We excised the bile duct and we thought that stricture is probably because of the hydatid fluid which is seeping out and causing a reactive stricture. So we excised the bile duct and performed hepaticojejunostomy and extended the cyst wall also to be included in the jejunostomy. We took precautions for spillage. So we thought we are dealing with a hydatid cyst. But to our surprise, when the biopsy histopathology came, finally, it was a cyst wall with a classical ovarian stroma, which was biliary cystadenoma, which we also reported this case in tropical gastroenterology. So sometimes it can be tricky even after imaging, after your intraoperative assessment. Cyst fluid aspiration can be useful in such situations. However, if you are able to see a scolex in the cyst fluid aspirate, yes, you can say confidently that you're dealing with a hydatid cyst. If you're not able to see a scolex, that doesn't still completely rule out a hydatid cyst. And also when you need to decide whether it is a borderline, has it become a calcific cyst yet, is it viable or not, in that also a cyst fluid aspirate may be helpful. There are studies which are coming up where an MR spectroscopy is a less invasive investigation which can do the same thing and tell us about the viability of the cyst. Serological tests, as I already mentioned, the sensitivity varies because there are a lot of methodology involved in the serological test, from indirect hemagglutination to ELISA to latex agglutination. And it also has an issue of specificity because there can be cross reactions, especially with other worms, and therefore it is not a very specific test. You may need to perform additional confirmatory tests like ARC5 test, complement test, and so on. The other tests which are important from the overall assessment would be a hemogram to look for any sepsis. Eosinophilia is seen in up to 40% of the cases. The liver function tests are sometimes elevated, especially the alkaline phosphatase and transaminases, which is suggestive of either compression or sometimes histopathology communication, cholangitis. Now, what are the treatment goals? The treatment goals is for treating this parasitic disease is to eliminate all possible viable parasite, that is the germinal layer that we are worried about, because otherwise it can recur. And the problem with different forms of treatment is relapse. So we want to avoid recurrence. At the same time, we want to minimize morbidity due to the procedure per se, like in the form of bleeding or biliary complications or delayed complications related to the cavity. So what are the options that we have? We have options vary right from wait and watch to medical measures to percutaneous measures to surgical measures and combined measures. The standard of care usually is a combination of medical measures and surgical measures. And in certain situations, there is an avenue to try minimally invasive methods like percutaneous measures. And if they are very small cysts, we think they are not viable, you can just wait and watch. So medical management, when do you offer medical management? One will be in a preoperative setting where we want to use it as a prophylaxis. One, it will reduce the cyst pressure. Second, if by any chance there is a spillage, the risk of secondary seeding is lowered. So that is why we use it in a preoperative setting. In patients who are unfit for surgery, where it is, or when you have a very disseminated surgery where you cannot really surgically remove everything, in that situation, medical management alone can be tried. And also when you have borderline viability, when you have a little bit of a doubtful diagnosis, you want to wait and watch. In such scenarios, one may consider medical therapy. It will not have any role if there is no viable parasite in a calcific cyst like a CE4. And also, it is contraindicated in early pregnancy, bone marrow suppressed states, because it will cause further suppression of the myelosuppression, and chronic liver disease, and large cysts at risk for rupture. Usually, we don't go for medical management. They are to be prioritized for surgery. The schedule that one uses for the medical management is usually, when you're using it for a definitive cure for this, that's usually done for the type 1 and 2. You use it anywhere between 3 to 6 months. Whereas the success rate is to the tune of about 80%. The relapse rate is quite high, about 20 to 25%. So they need to be kept on a very close follow-up. Most of these relapses will happen within the first 2 years. In the preoperative setting, at least a month, we can give it at least a month before, but if that is not possible, at least 3 days before surgery or a percutaneous intervention, it has to be initiated. After the procedure is completed, it is continued for about 2 months in uncomplicated cases or up to 6 months in complicated cases or when there is a spillage. The commonly used drugs are albendazole and metronidazole. Previously, drug-free gap of a week after a month was advised. However, there is no serious disadvantage to that, so it can be given continuously. The dose of albendazole being 10 to 15 milligram per kg per dose per day, and fat-rich meal will increase the bioavailability. Alternately, mebendazole also can be used. So, based on the stage as we discussed, so C1, C2, C3, C4, C5. So C4, C5 is where we are talking about the calcific non-viable parasite. So there it is going to be wait and watch. C1, again, we can just go for medical management. And if at all in a larger size, C1 opt for pair in addition. C2 and C3 usually are going to be for surgery. Percutaneous treatment can be offered in the C1, 2, 3. I will allude to a specific case selection in my subsequent slide. So PAIR, which is the percutaneous modality, is an acronym for puncture, aspiration, injection and re-aspiration. So this is usually offered to patients who are inoperable or those who refuse surgery, or in cases of a relapse which has happened after surgery and you want to avoid a re-surgery. When there is a failure to respond, when you've attempted a medicine alone kind of an approach. as a first line, it is preferable in CE1 and CE3A cysts, cysts which are bigger than 5 centimeters in addition to medical management. In CE2, which is your multiseptate cyst, and CE3B, where again you have a lot of solid matrix, and CE4 and 5, it is not going to work. And also a cystobiliary communication is contraindication because you don't want to inject a scolecystal into the biliary tract and cause an ascending cholangitis. The components or the steps of PAIR are percutaneous puncture under ultrasound guidance. This usually will be done as a transhepatic so as to avoid any spillage. Aspiration of the cyst fluid and then inject the scolecystal for about 10 to 15 minutes and then re-aspirate that. The risks associated with this procedure are if there is an missed biliary communication, it can cause cholangitis. And sometimes if there is an incomplete evacuation, it can cause secondary echinococcus spillage or recurrence. And sometimes if there is a spillage, it also can cause anaphylaxis. And the advantage of this is obviously that it is easily done with just an ultrasound. It has less costly compared to surgery. The proctoscolecytes which are usually used are 20% hypertonic saline or 95% alcohol. The puncture has to be transhepatic and not directly into the surface cyst. Prophylaxis has to be given prior to the PAIR with the albendazole. And it's important to assess for any communication for bile duct biliary communication, especially in large cysts. Whenever there is a large cyst, an alternative which is called as PAIR-D is where you put a catheter at first and drain out the contents and then reassess. Because one initially when the cyst pressure is very high, at that point the biliary communication may not be very obvious. Once the cyst is drained and the intracystic pressure comes down, there is a chance that the bile may start showing up. So you know that this patient, I do not want to select for PAIR. Or if it is a very small communication and with time you see that catheter, it is not showing any bile, it has stopped, then you can consider for a PAIR. And there are also other modified percutaneous techniques. Coming to the surgical options, there is a minimally invasive lap or robotic approach as well as the open approach. Open may be preferable for complicated cases where there are multiple lesions, where you have in a scenario of a recurrence, difficult to access for laparoscopy or robotic, where you're considering that it is encroaching onto the major vessels. Whereas simpler, easy to approach lesions, you would prefer a laparoscopy. And difficult approaches, posterior lesions, you can consider robotic surgery. With expertise, you can have a fair share of complex cases also being managed by laparoscopic technique. The other alveolar echinococcal disease will be treated either with resection when it is where it is fairly localized to a single lobe and spares the hilar structures. But when there is advanced disease with biliary cirrhosis or there is a vascular involvement producing Budd Chiari or extensive bilobar involvement, it has needed a liver transplantation in selected cases. Now, when you talk about the surgical options, one, you have the option of doing a radical surgery where it is going to be morbid, technically difficult, and the advantage of this is that the relapse is going to be very less. On the other hand, you have non-radical procedures which are much safer, easier to perform. However, they have a risk of higher relapse. So how do you choose between the two? So I'll talk about a few terminologies in this context. So you have a pericystectomy where you remove the cyst completely, either in a closed fashion without having to open the cyst at all, or a modified procedure where you open, sterilize the contents inside, and then you remove the cyst completely. So this is a more radical procedure. A slightly modified procedure is where we talk about total cystectomy. Peng et al. Have described this cleavage plane, which exists between probably the ectocyst, the pericyst and the ectocyst. And by going in this plane, the risk of bleeding and damage to liver and the vascular structures is much less. And this also permits a complete end-to-toe removal without having to open the cyst. So these are relatively radical procedures. And sometimes we may have to do a formal liver resection in the form of a right or a left or a posterior sectionectomy also, if it is a very extensive disease. The less radical procedures are something like partial cystectomy, where the cyst content is opened and content is completely, first it is sterilized, then it is opened, emptied, and then it is partially resected, and then the cavity is dead with different manners. Some it can be either packed with omentum or drain can be left, or it can be, some people would prefer to suture it. Now, where facilities and expertise for liver resection are not available, it may be a good idea to go for a partial cystectomy, though you will have a small chance of relapse. If we can take care that the medical prior prophylaxis has been given, spillage is avoided, this also will be a good procedure to offer. The basic principles of surgery remain the same. The spillage has to be avoided at all costs. Protection of at-risk areas with using sponges which are soaked in hypertonic saline or 10% povidone iodine. It's important to identify any cystobiliary communication. Sometimes if preoperatively there is cholangitis and if you already have a stent, it is helpful. If there is a high suspicion of cystobiliary communication, one of the ways to find it out would be to do a cholecystectomy, keep a small infant feeding tube into the cystic duct and inject some saline or methylene blue and see if there is any staining which is seen in the cavity. If it is a small opening, it can be closed by suturing it. If it is very large, one may have to do a cystogenostomy. And postoperatively in the drain, if you identify that there is bile leak, and if it is not a low volume, if it is causing sepsis, then these patients may need a ERCP sphincterotomy and a stent placement. Methods to deal with the cavity. One is it's important to check for completion of evacuation. Either it can be left open or pack or even drain. And all the contents preferably should be removed in a bag so that it doesn't come in contact with the peritoneal cavity. So this is one of the experiences of comparing conservative and radical surgery from my previous institute, where they looked at the conservative surgery and radical surgery. In our own experience at GB Panth, the recurrence rate was as high as 12% in conservative or less radical surgery, and it was as low as 2% in radical surgery. When they looked at literature with conservative surgery, the recurrence rate was somewhere between 10 to 25%, and with radical surgery, it was less than 4%. Also, when we look at other complications like bile leaks and cavity-related issues, they are somewhere in the range of 10 to 30% with conservative surgery, and these complications are about 3 to 7% with radical surgery. So, I will show a small video from our previous experience of laparoscopic cystopericystectomy, which was done. This was a 40-year-old male who had presented with a pain abdomen. This is the cyst which is seen. This is a cross-sectional imaging that we can see. After the laparoscopy, we divide the adhesions between the diaphragmatic surface. The cyst can be seen on the surface. After separating the diaphragmatic adhesions all around, we place mops which are packed with 10% povidone iodine, and then we go in the cleavage plane. Fusa is an useful adjunct to perform the dissection and delineate the cyst all around. Any vascular adhesions can be taken with the harmonic scalpel, harmonic shears, and if fusa is used in the correct plane, it is quite a bloodless plane. as we go closer to the superior surface, we will start encountering the vascular pedicles which are entering the segment of the liver. Those preferably can be clipped or stapled. So this is the pedicle which is seen entering. This was stapled. So the entire cyst is excised in toto. And then it is important to check for the on the cut surface. Sometimes you'll have another small satellite or another daughter cyst which is remaining, and check for hemostasis and also look for any bile leak in the cavity. Once we are satisfied with the bileostasis as well as the hemostasis, the specimen can be removed in a bag. It's a good idea to leave a gauze on the liver for some time and then remove the specimen, come back, see if there is any bile leak. It was placed in an endo bag and the umbilical port was extended and then removed. So this is a case of radical resection. Now I'll also show a video of a less radical, a partial cystectomy. So this is again a 39-year-old male with a C2 type of hydatid cyst, segment 5 and 6. Again, the adhesions to the omentum this time. This is on not on the diaphragmatic side, this is on the lower side. So the omental adhesions are released. The port of the trocar is introduced inside. The contents are emptied. We have checked, seeing that there is no bile. Is there any bile in that? The yellow stain which we are seeing is because we used povidone to sterilize the contents. After emptying the contents, then we excise the cyst wall partially. So that is a partial cystectomy. Postoperatively, these patients need to be kept on a follow-up with an ultrasound imaging. And every 6 months for the first 2 years is important to keep them on follow-up. Subsequently, based on the risk of recurrence, based on the size, was it complicated, was there any spillage, then we can decide how long to continue. But at least a yearly follow-up is recommended. Coming to alveolar echinococcal disease, the treatment principles for this is that radical surgery is the first choice in all cases which are suitable. An R0 resection, just like any other malignancy, need to be achieved. Benzimidazoles are mandatory in all patients. They need to be given after the surgery as well for a period of about 2 years. And sometimes if you are not able to resect it, it will go on for life. And if an R0 resection is not possible, it is not advisable to go for a palliative surgery, better to go for interventional percutaneous procedures. And these need to be monitored for a very long period, up to about 10 years or so. So there is a PNM staging for this, which is described, which we should be aware of, similar to a TNM classification for malignancy. So you have a PNM, that is P is for parasite, N is neighboring organ, and M is for metastasis. So when I say P1, it is peripheral lesions without any proximal vascular or biliary involvement. When I say P2, it is central lesions with proximal vascular or biliary involvement of one of the lobes. When I say P3, it is central lesions which are involving both the lobes, or there is involvement of at least the two hepatic veins. And P4 is when you have any liver lesion which extension along the major vessels, the cava, the portal vein, or the artery. So that tells the extent of the parasite. Neighboring organs including the diaphragm, the lung, the pleura, pericardium, the heart, stomach, bowel, adrenal, and kidney. So here, if there is no region involvement, it is N0. If it is region involvement is there, it becomes N1. And metastatic locations are non-contiguous locations like lungs, distant lymph nodes, spleen, the CNS, orbit, bone, skin, muscle, kidney, retroperitoneum in a non-contiguous fashion. So when this is present, it is called as M1. And this is based on a chest X-ray and a CT scan of the brain. Further, this is staged based on the P1, 2, 3 correspond to 1, 2, and 3A. When there is N1, there is neighboring organ involvement, it becomes 3B up to a P3 stage. The moment there is P4, that is extensive bilobar involvement in addition, it becomes a stage 4 disease. And based on this staging, the treatment is summarized, where for P1, P2, and some parts of P3, surgery is offered. In later stages, 3, 4, and N, resection cannot be offered. In a multidisciplinary discussion, transplant can be considered. Drug therapy is needed for all the stages. So when is liver transplantation considered? Whenever there is a severe liver insufficiency, especially in the setting of secondary biliary cirrhosis or Batchiari or recurrent cholangitis, inability to perform an R0 resection with a hepatectomy, and provided that extrahepatic locations are absent. In exceptional situations, when you have isolated lung involvement, you have to weigh the pros and cons, and you can extend the indication for transplant in such a scenario. Coming to the end of my presentation, so prevention is more important, and the WHO has focused on community measures. So, and this is mainly targeted in the endemic areas, where education is very important to highlight the role of hygiene, especially in slaughterhouses, and bring about appropriate legislation in such areas. Periodic inspection of the livestock and the infected animals, if needed, they need to be quarantined. You have these vaccines for the sheep called the recombinant EG95, which are used in the high-risk vaccines, high-risk livestock. And so a combination of vaccination, deworming, and a systematic slaughter can help eliminate echinococcosis. I thank you for your attention and any discussion.
Wonderful presentation, Saravanan.
Thank you, sir.
Lovely. Lovely. As I said, as an overview is, you know, complete. Any queries, any questions? And I will. Pradapana, are you there?
Good evening, yes. Sir. Just would like to. My question is regarding the hydatidcyst was found incidentally and the type was 4 or 5, so it's inactive. Shall I wait or see and just go for medical treatment? And the patient is asymptomatic.
Yeah. So if it is a type 5, then you are seeing that there is no viable parasite left. There is a completely calcific cyst. In that scenario, you don't need medical management as well. So you could just keep him on a wait and watch approach. Problem comes when you have a type 4 and you're not very sure that are you dealing with a type 4 or is it type 3B, 3A. So when you have a doubt whether you're dealing with 3A, 3B or 4, in that scenario, you can opt to keep them on a follow-up with medical management and then reassess. For a bit time, they may calcify, in which case the medical management also can be stopped.
Okay.
Dr. Patak, can I ask?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, this is Dr. Ravi Shankar, cardiothoracic surgeon, and I've been doing pulmonary hydatidcyst.
We can't often. See you, sir. Your camera is not in position or something.
One second. Can you see now? No. Okay, I'm audible, right?
Yeah, 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 you are, sir.
Yeah, so as I said, as a thoracic surgeon, I've been doing pulmonary hydrated chest, and many times we've done a combined pulmonary and liver hydrated by a thoracoabdominal incision. Now, my comment is a little different. The reason why we don't give a gap between the doses of albendazole or mebendazole is because there was a presumption that it was toxic. We know it is not. But what happened is, in the 2 weeks gap that you give, the scoliosis start multiplying. The daughter cysts start multiplying. So the very idea of giving the drug had lost its value. The other comment is, at times we've seen a PET scan picking up a pulmonary hydrated, because the FDG uptake in the periphery, which is the compressed lung tissue, is very high compared to the central portion, which is the endocyst. Is there any such finding in the liver hydrated?
Yes, sir. If it is an active cyst, even in a liver, it would be FDG evident, it can be picked up. And with the increasing use of cross-sectional imaging, yes, we are seeing these being picked up.
Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah, Pradhan.
Yeah, I have two queries. First query, when you see a calcified hydrated cyst, is it mandatory to do surgery if the patient is asymptomatic? Because there were teachings saying that if you have a calcified cyst, the chances of an active hydrated is less. Second question is regarding biliary communication. If there is a cyst biliary communication, does it lead to death of the cyst? Because I have read somewhere that if there is biliary communication, that will lead to death of the hydrated. Is it like that, or you have to give all the anti-hydrated drugs?
Yeah, so I'll start with your last question.
Yeah.
Since when there is a cystobiliary communication, the bile is actually a potent scholicidal. So as you said, it usually sterilizes the contents. So you don't need to add any scholicidal agent. And also one has to be careful, because in a situation when there is a cystobiliary communication, only if you're using hypertonic saline, that the chances of cholangitis are less. Even that, one would not want to take a chance. So, if there is a cystobiliary communication, there is no need to sterilize it. However, there is no data on this as such. This is again being like a standard teaching which has been told to us. Second, about a calcified cyst. If it is a completely calcified cyst, it is easy to tackle. We just can keep them on follow-up without needing to offer them even a medical management. But the problem comes when they are not completely calcific. We are seeing some heterogeneity within, and there is some calcific wall, and we are assessing this by ultrasound, where it is poorly it's reflecting, so you can't really assess completely. So in such a scenario, probably one may have to continue with medical management, and it will also help making it unviable. And once the calcification is complete, you can stop it.
A third, one more question I have. You presented a case, presentation of biliary cystadenoma rupturing into the bile duct. I think that presentation is more common in biliary cystadenoma, not in hydrated cyst, because we have come across two such situations, but I have never seen a hydrated getting ruptured or coming through the bile duct, because it will not be active when it communicate with the bile duct. So if you see a cyst content inside the bile duct, many a time the diagnosis has to be biliary cystadenoma rather than hydrated cyst. So that is one observation we made, and that is correct in as per literature also.
Yeah. Thanks for the documentation.
So any other comments from the audience, please?
Sir, I'm Dr. Ashok here.
Yes, sir, please. First time we are seeing a picture.
Hello, sir?
First time I'm seeing a picture, I say.
Okay. So the question is, how often we follow the WHO classification based on the ultrasound? Because ultrasound has got a operative dependency, right? So classification in CEA 1, 2, 3, 4, it becomes difficult, and there's quite an overlap based on the person who is doing the ultrasound. So what I feel and what I practice most of the time is all the symptomatic cysts to be operated. What is your comment on it?
Yes, sir, I completely agree with you that once a cyst is symptomatic, and in fact, most of us see patients coming with some form of complication. So that is how they get picked up. Very rarely we will see that it has been picked up as an incident lumus. So when they're symptomatic, yes, we definitely go ahead and address them. Now, problem comes when they are asymptomatic. So what we try to do is we try to standardize and have a discussion with our radiologists in such cases, so that they are also tuned to the classification and we have some amount of uniformity. But most often, whenever they are asymptomatic, it becomes difficult to distinguish from a bilirubin cyst adenoma, in which case you don't want to be observing them. So I think that is important. And in that case, a CT or an MR will be useful to determine whether they need to be addressed or not.
Okay, thank you.
Saranan, I had seen a couple of cases of disseminated intraabdominal hydradenitis. And actually, frankly, they don't do so very well. Have you seen any? And Pradhan, yes, sir. Have you?
So in GB Pant, we had seen a case like what Dr. Ravi Shankar was mentioning, where we had a lung and abdomen and a pelvic. There were multiple, and so we also collaborated and did a laparoscopic for the abdominal, and we did a transthoracic resection for the lung hydrated. We also had another patient. I was not able to get the pictures. I was just searching it today. It was completely studded, so we thought there's no way that they're going to be able to pick each one. We just left that patient alone. We just put him on medical management lifelong and left him.
Pradhavan, you have any experience with multiple hydrated all over them? I don't know whether Pradhavan is there or is left.
The only problem that is difficulty is that if you have such a scenario where you have a disseminated disease and then you have a complication in one of them, there is some suppuration, then how to go about how to deal? Sometimes it's difficult to make out which one is really caused the trouble. Yeah. So that can be a challenging situation. Anything like such a situation, sir?
Mm-hmm. Any other question from the audience? If there are none, again, thanks so much, Saranan, for taking up this not so easy topic and then spending the evening with us. And thank you. Thanks once again. And I'll see you again soon.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.